Hi everybody, it's great to be back here again on Eat Some Art. It's Friday, and guess where we are, my friends? This is a very special treat, and I have to really first put my sunglasses on. Anyway, although we see the clouds in the background and the sun in one end, right now we are literally standing, or sitting, to be more accurate, on the highest point of Itamar, which is called the lookout point of the three seas. It's the only place in Israel that you can see the three seas from one location, the Dead Sea, the Mediterranean Sea, and the Sea of the Galilee. And right behind me over here, when I just turn on this way, we're looking in the direction of the beautiful mountains of Gerizim and Eival, the mountains of the blessing and the curse. And these famous mountains represent something very powerful. They represent the covenant in the land of Israel, receiving Torah in the land. And what is so special about this area? Why am I taking you all up over here on a nice fall day with clouds? It's been raining a bit here. What am I doing? And the answer is, this week's portion is Parshat Lech Lecha. And we know that in Parshat, for example, Chayei Sarah, everyone runs to Chevron. On Parshat Lech Lecha, it's not as well known, but this is really the central portion of one of the central portions of Itamar, because we have a few in the Torah, that really focus on Abraham, focuses on the beginning of the Jewish people. And it's so special that we have the privilege of living in this area, an area where literally our history begins as the nation of Israel. I'd like to begin by reading a few of these verses, and then focusing on our major point for this week's portion. First of all, the Torah starts out by, of course, God saying, "Vayomer Hashem el Avraham," and God says to Abraham, "Lech lecha me'artzecha, moladitcha, leave your home, your birthplace, to the land that I will show you." And then it says in verse, again, chapter 12, we look in verse number 6. This is our powerful verse we're looking for. It says, "Vayavo Avram ba'aretz," and Abram came to the land, right over there, right behind me. Ad mekom Shechem, to the place of Shechem. Right behind me is the city of Shechem. Ad Elon Moreh, to Elon Moreh, which is another name for the city of Shechem. Va'knani az ba'aretz, and in that time the Canaanites were in the land of Israel. So picture, we're going back thousands of years, 4,000 years, whatever it is. Abraham, right over here, behind me, is walking along these valleys right over here, coming to the place of Shechem. And what does he do when he comes to Shechem? God says, "Vayera Hashem el Avram vayomer." God appears to Abraham when he enters the land. He says to him, "Lizaracha eten et haaretz hazo, to your children I will give him this land." Yes, this beautiful land right over here, I will give to your children, God says to Abraham. And vayiven sham mizbech, what does Abraham do immediately? He builds an altar to God, which God appears to him right away, to, again, as a thanksgiving, to thank Hashem for the blessing of giving this beautiful land of Israel. He builds right behind us an altar. And it's very interesting, that same place later on, an altar is built over there. By who? We know that altar is built by his place.
מה אתה מחפש? אני באתי לקנות באוטו, אני לקחתי פה מהבטלס. אני פעם ראשונה פה, אני מראשון. אני כבר 15 שנים בארץ.
ואף פעם לא היית פה?
הייתי עם אשתי פעם אחת באריאל. זה לא אוסטריה, זה לא איטליה, זה לא גרמניה, זה לא מתקדם.
מקום מדהים, לא?
אוי, משהו...
אמרתי, אני בא לכאן, אני אעשה איזה שיעור, אף אחד לא ישמע, יש שקט. אתה עוזר, אתה עוזר. אתה אומר שהם יהיו, ויש אנשים מגיעים ומבקרים באיתמר.
כן, איתמר.
איפה אתה גר?
בראשון לציון.
וואו.
אבל אני באתי דרך ערבים, היא שאלה אותי איך אני באתי. אני אמרתי שאני באתי דרך ערבים. הייתי במחניות, וזה לא מכיר. זה מסוכן, לא? היא אומרת שזה מסוכן. היא אומרת, לא הספקתי להרגיש, אני נסעתי את הרבה.
וואי, וואי.
די מהר.
יופי, אז...
יכול להיות שבדרך חזרה אני צריך לדפות כביש הזה?
לא, איך באת? בדרך גיבי?
משם. מאריאל ישר לפה.
אה, זה הדרך שכולנו יוצאים.
מה? אז סבבה.
זה הדרך. אתה יודע איך לצאת מפה?
ודאי. לא, אני קודם כל צריך להחזיר לה את האוטו ולקחת ג'יפ שלי.
אה, אוקיי. טוב, אז ברוך הבא.
שלחת, אני יום טוב ושבת שלום.
שבת שלום, ביי ביי.
סליחה שהפרעתי.
אין בעיה, שלום. You know, wow, this is, you know something, I think I'll leave this on the lesson, this thing, I could have easily erased that little that little, what's it called, clip of someone driving by in a Jeep. I said, I'm going to come all over the mountain. Who's going to get up here? It's the quietest place in the world. Who's going to be bothering me up here on the mountain? And here a man's driving by. He lives in Rishon, he told me he lives in Rishon LeZion, which is down south. The first time he's here in Itamar, he came to buy a car from somebody here. Now he just drove around looking for whatever it was going to. He said he knows where he is. But it was funny that he drove around. He said he's amazed by the beautiful view. And here he is, a person, a Jew, living far away in Rishon LeZion, in the coastal area of Israel, comes up to the mountain and is amazed by the beauty of the land, because the soul feels, you feel that here is where it all began. This is really what we began as a people of Israel, right over here, what you're looking at. Now, Abraham, of course, is our forefather. It all begins with Abraham. And when people ask me, why do we set up tent over here in Itamar? Why do we make a community over here in Itamar? And of course, that's the answer. The answer is our everlasting connection to our forefathers. And this is where it all starts, where Abraham began. I would quickly like to mention, you know, again, that this lesson should be in Refuah Shleima, for a speedy healing of Rabbi Yehuda Glick, who was, unfortunately, we all heard a terrible tragedy, was attempted assassination just a couple of days ago, because of one reason, that he loves the land of Israel and he's trying to strengthen and fight for the Jewish right, the God-given right of the people of Israel, to build our temple, to return to the Temple Mount, together with many other great people that are working very hard in that area in our time. And unfortunately, you know, the world, instead of strengthening Israel and realizing how important our temple is for the people of Israel, who God gave the land to us, constantly battling against us. We heard this week the terrible remarks by the White House against our Prime Minister. Terrible, terrible things that were said, which is no doubt blatant anti-Semitism against Israel, when you're attacking a leader of Israel. Obviously, it's blatant anti-Semitism, which you would never expect this kind of thing to happen to America. It's supposed to be a great friend of Israel. Israel is truly the only democracy in this area, and a true ally, and this is what it gets back from America, which is a disgrace. Whatever it is, this lesson is, again, as I mentioned, will be in the for the speedy healing of Rabbi Glick, and again, for the for Israel, to strengthen Israel, every bit of Torah we study, to strengthen our people, and to show our connection that we have to the land of Israel over here. Today, I want to focus on Lot. Lot is a very, very interesting character in our portion, in that, number one, he's less spoken about because Abraham usually takes over. And everyone talks about Abraham coming to the land. That really stands out more than anything. But Lot is a very important character we have to understand. And I heard some very special things with the Chalban and the rabbi, again, I mentioned before, the famous Kabbalist. I'd like to bring some of his ideas down. Lot, for example, the word itself, Lot, has within it the word meaning a curse. Lot in Hebrew is the Aramaic word of to curse. And the question is, who's this character? Not only that, you have to realize that the fact that Lot was taken by Abraham to the land of Israel, he wasn't left out there in Mesopotamia, he was taken to the land of Israel. And Israel doesn't accept, so many people don't forget, the land eventually will vomit out the evil out of the land, as it says. It's not something to be taken or for granted, or not to pay attention to the fact that Lot is absolutely a very, very unusual character, that he was taken to the land by Abraham, adopted by Abraham, and there must be something very special within him himself. On the other hand, we have difficult issues with Lot, and we're going to read about them now. If you look in chapter 13, verse number 5, it talks about Lot. V'gam Lot ha'olechet Avraham ha'yatzon uvakav olim. He was very wealthy. He had flock and cattle and sheep, whatever it was, and tents, and the land couldn't deal with them together. And there was an argument between the shepherds of Abraham and Lot. So what does Abraham say to Lot? He goes, there shouldn't be any kind of arguments between us. The entire land's in front of you. If you go to the right, you know, whatever, I'll go to the left. You go to the left, I'll go to the right. Abraham is suggesting that they separate. And the question is, why did Abraham want to separate from Lot? He was his, you know, he calls him with brothers. Why did he separate from Lot? He took him to Israel, now he wants to separate from his brother. Doesn't make sense so much. And then it goes on to say, of course, the simple reason that there was an argument, the land, but still it doesn't seem like Abraham, who's so capable of bringing people back to God, and that's his whole being. Is, you know, he prayed for the for Sodom and Amorah that they shouldn't be destroyed. He doesn't give up, so it seems in a way he's giving up on his nephew. And anyway, it says right away, if you look at verse 10, Vayisa Lot et einav, and Lot lifts his eyes up, Vayaret kol kikar yaden, he sees the entire valley of Jordan, ki kulam mashkeh, which is a complete, mashkeh means it's very fertile. It's, you know, it has a lot of water, lefnei shachet Hashem et Sodom et Amorah, before God destroyed Sodom and Amorah, ki gan Hashem keretz Mitzrayim, it was like the land of Egypt. We know they have the Nile River, which they don't even have to worry about rain like we do here. We're praying for these clouds to give forth rain because we don't have what they have in Egypt, a Nile constantly flowing all year round. And here, similarly, the Sodom and Amorah area had the natural resource of water in there at that time. So that's where immediately Lot lifts his eyes up. And it says, listen, very interesting, the verse number 13, it says, no, 12 first, so it says, I'm sorry, in 11, Vayivchal Lot et kol kikar Aden, right? He chooses that area. And Vayisal Lot mekedem, and he traveled away from Kedem, meaning from the east. Vayipoldu Yishmael Lechiv, and they separated from his brother. Then it says, Avum Yishav Beretz Kanan, Abraham dwelt in the land of Kanan. Velot Yishav Barei Kikar, and Lot, he dwelled in the city of, in the cities of the Kikar. And he set up his tent over there, in that area, in the Sodom and Amorite area. And then in verse number 13 it says, V'anshei Sodom ra'im v'chatim l'ashem ma'od. And the people of Sodom were very evil and sinful to God, very, very. Stressing in verse number 13 the fact that Sodom were very evil. Now what do we see over here? Lot did not bother, wasn't concerning him too much that he was going to live amongst evil people. He decided, because of the beautiful wealth that area contained, that was more important than anything. And he was willing to live amongst the evil in order to, what? Have money and do well and be successful. And that itself is a very, very, again, a sign of what kind of character we're talking about. But here we see something again. I feel a few raindrops on my back now. Yes, these clouds are giving forth rain as we're praying for it. But anyway, Abraham, you know, he let his nephew go away from him. On the other hand, he could have easily kept him with him to try to lift him up. And the answer is, Abraham, everything he did was very measured and very, 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 very exact. And certain times people, when they're around the righteous, you know, the natural people that study Torah and learn, they don't have to go far away sometimes to the bad, darkest places to try to find God. But here we see something very interesting. This was, again, I said before, the Chalman teaches, is that Abraham really saw that Lot needed to go to the evil. Because sometimes when you're amongst the evil and you feel, you see the dirt and the sewer, then you can lift yourself up and realize and look for, find Hashem, find God in the world. And that's one of the very, very important ways of repentance. Others don't need to go through that long system. Today we see in Israel many people running to Hodu, running, you know, to India and other places to try to find themselves and whatever, until they return to God. And they have to go through the fire, is what my mother-in-law likes saying. Go through the fire all the time. Certain times they have to go through the fire. And then they come back and then they realize, wow, you know, how important it is for a person to find himself. And they realize only when they're living amongst such a sewer, they feel the lack of godliness and make a change in their lives. And Lot himself, really, that's what he did. He really sheared off the husks when he was there. As we see later on, that he's inviting in guests and he starts to... After being through that system of evil, and Abraham coming to fight, to defend his nephew, he didn't forget about his nephew, he came to fight for him. And here we see this entire war, it's explained by our sources, really was for the sake of Lot, for Lot to rectify himself. And here we see right away the king of Sodom after the war, what does he say to Abraham? He says, give me the people and take the possessions. Right away, the first thing on his mind is possessions, money. He doesn't think about that Abraham could go ahead and do a war for the sake of righteousness, for the sake of justice in the world. He's not interested in money and interested in all kinds of other side things. He's interested in doing what's right in God's eyes. And that is what Abraham's all about. And that's what he wanted Lot to find when Lot went out there. Amongst them himself, he wanted Lot to see that when you're amongst evil, sometimes that helps you realize your great lot, etc. Lot is a lot, right? Sounds like... But anyway, it's very interesting that Lot, we know, is the spark of Messiah. which is amazing. Abraham saw that all the time. That from Lot, from his daughter, don't forget, he had two children, right, for his daughters, Moab and Ammon. From Moab comes the root, from comes King David, the Messiah, the spark of Messiah, is hidden within Lot, and therefore he has to come to the land of Israel. Abraham must rectify him, but Abraham rectifies in a very, very special, unique way by having to be amongst this dome. From there, just to realize what his lot is, but doesn't happen right away. It still has to go through a more cleansing process later on through the children to eventually, finally, the spark of Messiah will rise and come out of Lot, from Lot's seed. And we see how everything is very, very exact, and it's all has to do with rectifying, of course, the sin of the first man. But here I am right now sitting in the rain, and I guess it's a sign that if I don't get up soon, I'm going to get soaking wet. But it's a blessing to be here, to see the raindrops come down from the sky to fertile the land of Israel. Such a beautiful, beautiful, special sign of abundance. This is the time of today. It was the first day we began to pray for the rain. We mentioned rain on the holiday of Sukkot. But today we begin in Israel on the seventh day of Cheshvan. We begin to pray for rain, and rain is here the first day. So thank God, it's a blessing. And here we are again in the background of Abraham when it all began. I'm happy to bring you here to my backyard. Love you all. Shabbat shalom. We'll catch each other very soon again. Shalom, shalom. And please come to visit. This is what you can see. Shabbat shalom. Bye-bye.